Liebe Damen und Herren, sehr geehrter Herr Bundeskanzler, sehr geehrte Frau Rektorin Hanna Beegger, dear Eric Schmidt, ich darf Sie recht herzlich hier heute Nachmittag an der Wiener Wirtschaftsuniversität begrüßen und freue mich außerordentlich, dass ich es sein darf, die Sie heute durch den Nachmittag und die nächsten 1,5 Stunden führen darf. Mein Name ist Anna-Maria Wallner, ich bin Medienredakteurin in der Tageszeitung Die Presse und außerdem Leiterin der Sonntagszeitung, die wir seit einigen Jahren machen. Es freut mich sehr, dass ich es bin, die jetzt durch diese Veranstaltung führen darf. Ich möchte mich nur ganz kurz auch entschuldigen, dass meine Stimme etwas angeschlagen ist und mich, wie man so schön auf Wienerisch sagt, ein ordentlicher oder ein Batzen Schnupfen erwischt hat vor ein paar Tagen, der mich noch nicht ganz losgelassen hat. Wir kennen die Debatten und wir wissen, wie sie meist geführt werden. Amerika ist Weltmarktführer bei Innovationen im technischen Bereich, in Social Media Dingen und in IT-Bereichen. Mittlerweile tut sich auch was in Südkorea oder in China, sagt man dann gerne. Und die alte Welt Europa, die gilt sehr oft als zwar vergeistigt und sehr gescheit, aber doch irgendwie behäbig und sehr an alten Prinzipien hängend, zu wenig mutig. Aber stimmt dieses Bild überhaupt noch oder hat es sich schon verändert? Genau darum dreht sich unsere kommende Veranstaltung und genau dazu wollen unsere Gäste, sprechen, wie schon erwähnt, Bundeskanzler Sebastian Kurz und Eric Schmidt. Zuallererst möchte ich ganz gerne die Hausherrin auf die Bühne bitten, Direktorin der WU, die uns offiziell den Nachmittag begrüßen wird. Willkommen.
Ja, sehr verehrter Herr Bundeskanzler, dear Mr. Schmidt, a very warm welcome at WU Vienna and at our very beautiful campus, although you didn't see much, but sorry for that. Ja, aber vor allem natürlich, werte und liebe Studierende der Wirtschaftsuniversität Wien, aber auch der Technischen Universität Wien und ja, werte Gäste. Ich darf Sie sehr herzlich begrüßen hier an der WU Wien. Ich freue mich, dass Sie so zahlreich erschienen sind, obwohl Freitagnachmittag, aber ich denke, das ist vor allem dem Thema geschuldet. Europa als globaler Innovation Leader, Traum oder mögliche Realität? Warum haben wir uns als WU für diese Veranstaltung, für dieses Thema zur Verfügung gestellt? Ja, das hat im Wesentlichen drei Gründe. Erstens die Location. Der WU-Campus ist von 6 internationalen Architekturbüros entworfen und gebaut worden und umfasst ca. 100.000 Quadratmeter Nutzfläche. Wir sind in vielerlei Hinsicht Vorreiter. Der Campus ist barrierefrei, hat das Green Building Zertifikat und ist mit der modernsten State-of-the-Art-Technologie ausgestattet, wird permanent akkreditiert und zertifiziert, das heißt, entwickelt sich also kontinuierlich weiter. Ich darf also mit ruhigem Gewissen sagen, dass wir selbst ein Ort moderner und hochinnovativer Universität sind und daher ein sehr guter Ort für die heutige Veranstaltung. Zweiter Grund, als eine Universität ist die WU selbstverständlich Teil eines Innovationsnetzwerkes. Innovationsnetzwerke zeichnen sich dadurch aus, dass sich verschiedene Institutionen zum Zwecke des Austausches von Wissen und Ressourcen zusammenschließen. Damit wird ein Raum für Innovation geschaffen. Gerade Universitäten als Forschungsinstitutionen, aber auch als Ort der Bildung und persönlicher Entwicklung junger Menschen, sind mit ihren internationalen Kontakten ganz wichtige Knoten in Innovationsnetzwerken. Universitäten wie die WU haben also ein ureigenes Interesse daran, dass Europa ein Innovation Leader wird und spielen selbst eine wichtige Rolle darin, dieses Ziel zu erreichen. So werden in Bezug auf Technologie und Digitalisierung an vielen europäischen Universitäten und Forschungseinrichtungen substanzielle Entwicklungen vorangetrieben. Wichtig bei diesem Thema ist aber ganz besonders die interdisziplinäre Betrachtung. Digitalisierung benötigt nicht nur technologische Entwicklungen, es braucht auch einen umfassenden Ansatz. So haben wir zum Beispiel ein eigenes Forschungsinstitut für Kryptoökonomie, das die Potenziale der Blockchain-Technologie untersucht und eben hier technische, aber eben auch ökonomische, soziale und rechtliche Themen erforscht. Und wir haben auch erst gestern die freudige Nachricht gekriegt, dass es ein Austrian Blockchain Center als Kompetenzzentrum an der WU geben wird. Das heißt, im Rahmen des Programms COMET werden 26 Millionen Euro Fördermittel zur Stärkung des Kompetenz- und Forschungsstandortes Österreich freigegeben. Ich finde es also daher sehr gut, dass die heutige Veranstaltung nicht nur von Studierenden der WU, sondern wie gesagt insbesondere auch von der TU Wien besucht wird, denn Innovation braucht technisches Wissen und Wirtschaftswissen. Der dritte Grund, warum wir das hier heute gerne organisiert haben: als öffentliche Universität schaffen wir Raum für Diskurs und bekennen uns zum Wissenstransfer. Die WU wird, wie auch die anderen öffentlichen Universitäten, hauptsächlich aus öffentlichen Geldern finanziert. Damit haben wir auch eine Pflicht, Diskursräume zu schaffen und den Austausch von Wissenschaft, Politik und Wirtschaft zu fördern. Die WU als einzige Wirtschaftsuniversität Österreichs hat natürlich ein ganz besonderes Verhältnis zur Wirtschaft und kooperiert mit ihr auch in vielerlei Hinsicht. Unsere Unternehmenspartner geben uns nicht nur Impulse für Forschungsprojekte, bringen sich in die Lehre ein, sondern sie unterstützen uns auch in vielen zahlreichen Projekten. Wir laden daher auch immer wieder sehr gerne hochkarätige Vertreter und Vertreterinnen aus der Wirtschaft ein. Erst unlängst war Western Union-Chef Hikmet Ersek zu Gast bei uns. Er ist der einzige Österreicher an der Spitze eines Fortune 500-Unternehmens und nebenbei, das darf ich schon als Rektorin stolz bemerken, WU-Alumnus. Und heute dürfen wir mit Eric Schmidt natürlich einen weiteren sehr beeindruckenden Manager begrüßen, den ehemaligen CEO von Google und nunmehrigen Aufsichtsrat von Alphabet. Und natürlich ist es auch unser Verständnis, mit dem wissenschaftlich generierten Wissen einen Beitrag zur evidenzbasierten Politik zu leisten. Wir freuen uns also auch immer, wenn Vertreter und Vertreterinnen der Politik an die WU kommen, wie letztens die drei Bundespräsidenten aus Österreich, Deutschland und der Slowakei oder heute auch der Bundeskanzler. Noch mehr freuen wir uns aber natürlich als Universität, wenn wissenschaftliche Empfehlungen ernst genommen werden und sie in politische Entscheidungen auch tatsächlich einfließen. Da fürchte ich, ist in Österreich noch ein bisschen Luft nach oben. Wie kann es Europa also schaffen, zu einem Innovation Leader zu werden? Das soll heute erörtert werden. Ich darf Sie also in diesem Sinne noch einmal sehr herzlich begrüßen, darf für Ihr Interesse und Ihr Kommen danken und einen spannenden und ganz im akademischen Sinne konstruktiven, aber auch kritischen Diskurs wünschen. Dankeschön.
Vielen Dank. Vielen Dank für diese Eröffnungsworte. Wir bleiben noch bei den Eröffnungsworten und Begrüßungsworten und ich darf jetzt Frau Dr. Antonella May-Pochtl auf die Bühne bitten. Sie ist Sonderbeauftragte vom Bundeskanzler Sebastian Kurz und Leiterin der Stabsstelle Strategie, Analyse und Planung im Bundeskanzleramt, dem Think Austria, und eine der Initiatorinnen dieses heutigen Nachmittags.
Ja, vielen Dank, liebe Frau Rektorin, vielen Dank, dass wir hier sein dürfen. Das ist beeindruckend. Eric, you had not the chance to see outside how beautiful it is. It's really beautiful. Und ich habe heute was gelernt. Wir haben einen Bundeskanzler, der auch simultan übersetzen kann. Also vielen Dank, Sebastian, dass du da eingesprungen bist. Das ist Multitasking ist sehr wichtig. Das kann jeder von uns lernen. Ich freue mich ganz besonders, dass wir hier sind. Es ist die erste Think Austria Veranstaltung. Wir haben vor 9 Monaten angefangen. Dank der guten Idee, dass wir out of the box und über den Tellerrand denken sollen. Und es ist natürlich hier der beste Platz, um das zu machen, nicht nur, weil es ja so ein Landmark-Building ist, sondern weil es ein Talent-Hub ist. Ja? Und vor allem ein Talent-Hub mit vielen jungen Leuten. Und die sind diejenigen, die ja auch am besten die Zukunft gestalten. Deswegen freue ich mich ganz besonders. Jetzt ist es so, dass wir uns überlegt haben, was ist denn das erste Thema, mit dem wir uns beschäftigen wollen? Und da ist uns vor einigen Wochen der Economist hat uns so eine Steilvorlage gegeben und hat geschrieben: Europe's history explains why it will never produce a Google. Und da haben wir gedacht, naja, das nehmen wir echt als Steilvorlage, das werden wir Ihnen zeigen. Und dann haben wir uns gedacht, um es Ihnen zu zeigen, holen wir uns denjenigen her, der den Google mit erschaffen hat, mit Eric Schmidt. Und Eric, you know, our expectations are very high. We really want to create the prerequisites to create the next Google. And so we are very keen to hear from you how we can do that. I know, you like the difficult tasks, you told us so. Yeah. Also deswegen wollen wir natürlich hören, wie das geht. Jetzt ist es so, dass wir uns überlegen müssen, wie starten wir bei dieser Aufgabe. Wenn wir jetzt zurückschauen, vor 10 Jahren waren die 10 wertvollsten Unternehmen, waren davon 6 in der Energie- und im Industriebereich, 3 Fintechs oder Financial Services und ein Tech-Unternehmen, Microsoft. Das war vor 10 Jahren. 10 Jahre später jetzt sind die meisten, die wertvollsten Unternehmen, Tech-Unternehmen. Und wenn wir jetzt aber schauen, was ist das letzte Tech-Unternehmen, was aus Europa entstanden ist, das ist SAP, immerhin top, aber nicht unter den Top 50 wertvollsten Unternehmen der Welt. Also das ist nicht optimal. Zweiter Datenpunkt, wenn wir sehen, wie viel Apple in R&D investiert. Apple investiert 14 Milliarden im Jahr. Wisst ihr, wie viel Österreich in R&D investiert? Ungefähr das Gleiche, 13,9 Milliarden. Also wir investieren so viel wie Apple. Also das ist ganz wichtig, um das einmal in Relation zu setzen. Nun, es klingt alles negativ, aber es gibt sehr viel Positives, was wir sagen können. Und ich möchte vor allem mit positiven Themen anfangen. Was haben wir denn als Basis? Wir haben in Österreich die höchste F&E-Quote pro Kopf. Wir haben die höchste Anzahl Hidden Champions pro Kopf. Das sind nicht nur Kristalle und Energy Drinks und Seilbahnen, sondern auch Feuerfestprodukte und Druckgasbehälter, ja, und Ziegeln auch, ja. Also da sind einige Hidden Champions. Wir haben einen sehr hohen Industrial Output pro Kopf, aber vor allem wir haben sehr viele gute Studenten. Wien ist die größte Studentenstadt im deutschsprachigen Raum. Und darauf wollen wir aufbauen. Und Europa kann sich sehen lassen, wir haben mehr Nobelpreisträger als USA. Also denken können wir noch. Also jetzt müssen wir nur aus dem Denken was machen. Also das sind alles gute Voraussetzungen und ich möchte dann auch das übergeben an den Bundeskanzler. Aber bevor wir da auf dieses Thema eingehen, kurz eine Reflexion. Vor etwas über 100 Jahren hat Schumpeter, da war er gerade knapp über 25, hat er zum ersten Mal das Thema, sozusagen, was er später dann die kreative Zerstörung genannt hat, beschrieben und hat von dem Konzept des schöpferischen Unternehmers gesprochen. Und ich hoffe sehr, dass wir hier unter euch sehr viele dieser schöpferischen Unternehmer animieren werden und animieren können, das neue Google, das zukünftige Google aufzubauen. Und in diesem Sinne, vielen Dank, Eric, for your inspiration that we will get. Und vielen Dank, Sebastian, dir, lieber Bundeskanzler, dass es Think Austria gibt, weil es, wenn es uns nicht gäbe, gäbe es auch diese Veranstaltung nicht. Vielen Dank.
Ja, vielen Dank. Da ist eigentlich nicht mehr sehr viel dazu hinzuzufügen. Ich freue mich jetzt, Bundeskanzler Sebastian Kurz auf die Bühne zu bitten, der uns die erste Keynote des Nachmittags halten wird. Vielen Dank.
Vielen Dank, sehr geehrte Damen und Herren, liebe Studierende, und sind zwar hauptsächlich Männer da, aber auch die weiblichen Studierenden sind herzlich begrüßt. Ich freue mich ganz besonders, Frau Rektorin, danke, dass wir an der Wirtschaftsuniversität zu Gast sein dürfen, dass Eric Schmidt heute da ist. Vielen, vielen Dank, Eric, dass du die Einladung nach Österreich angenommen hast. Wir haben immer wieder uns in den USA treffen und unterhalten dürfen. Ich habe viele Ideen und Anregungen mitnehmen dürfen und nach oftmaligen Fragen hast du dann auch die Bitte erhört, uns in Österreich zu besuchen und auch für eine Diskussion, gerne auch für eine kritische Diskussion zur Verfügung zu stehen. Ist Europa ein Innovation Leader? Wenn wir uns diese Frage stellen, dann müssen wir wahrscheinlich ganz ehrlich beantworten, nicht so sehr, wie wir das in unserer Geschichte schon einmal waren. Wir sind vorher mit dem Auto gemeinsam hergefahren und Eric Schmidt hat gesagt, das ist ja beeindruckend, Wien, das schaut ja aus wie die Hauptstadt eines Empires. Waren wir auch einmal vor etwas mehr als 100 Jahren. Auch die Europäische Union hat sicherlich und Europa Zeit der Geschichte hindurch immer als Innovation Leader gegolten. Wenn wir uns die Entwicklung der letzten Jahre ansehen, dann müssen wir wahrscheinlich zugeben, dass wir zurückgefallen sind und dass wir auch nicht in dem Ausmaß Innovation Leader sind, wie wir es als Europa gerne wären. Die gute Nachricht ist aber, das muss nicht so bleiben. Wir leben alle in einer Zeit der massiven technologischen Entwicklung und der extrem schnellen Veränderung. Die Rechenleistung von Computern verdoppelt sich, Daumen mal Pi, glaube ich, alle 2 Jahre einmal. Wir erleben, dass wir in unserer Zeit eigentlich nur noch eine wirklich fixe Komponente haben und das ist Veränderung. Und auch wenn das geopolitische Umfeld und auch die Struktur in der Europäischen Union im Moment ein schwieriges ist, Spannungen mit Russland, schwierigere Situation mit den USA innerhalb der Europäischen Union, kaum ein globaler Fokus, da man mit dem Brexit und somit mit sich selbst beschäftigt ist, aber auch wenn es gerade herausfordernde Zeiten sind, so ist, glaube ich, trotzdem die Grundvoraussetzung in Europa gegeben. Rechtsstaatlichkeit, Demokratie, Friede, Freiheit, ein relativer Wohlstand ist nicht überall auf der Welt selbstverständlich und auch wenn der liberale Rechtsstaat heutzutage immer wieder in Frage gestellt wird, man in andere asiatische Länder blickt und der Meinung ist, Entscheidungen können dort schneller getroffen werden. Es gibt keine so langen Diskussionen darüber in Parlamenten. Wenn Entscheidungen getroffen sind, dann werden sie nicht gerichtlich aufgehoben. Also auch wenn viele damit liebäugeln, dass nicht liberale Rechtsstaaten wesentlich schneller sind in ihren Entscheidungen, so ist eigentlich doch nur im liberalen Rechtsstaat wirklich das Grundrecht eines jeden Einzelnen gesichert. Eigentum gegenüber auch dem Staat ist nur in liberalen Rechtsstaaten wirklich sicher möglich. Und es gibt auch nicht die Gefahr einer Alleinherrschaft eines Einzelnen. Es sind also beste Grundvoraussetzungen für eine nachhaltige Entwicklung und auch für nachhaltige Innovation. Was Antonella May-Pochtler aber zu Recht angesprochen hat, ist die Veränderung, wenn man auf die großen Player der Wirtschaft blickt. Jetzt habe ich persönlich kein Problem damit, dass unter den am besten bewertetsten Unternehmen der Welt mittlerweile hauptsächlich innovationsgetriebene Technologieunternehmen sind. Dass das 7 von 10 ist, ist beeindruckend. Das allein wäre nicht das Problem. Dass von den 7 Technologiekonzernen, die unter den besten 10 bewertetsten Unternehmen der Welt sind, aber 5 aus den USA und 2 aus China sind und kein einziges aus der Europäischen Union, das sollte uns doch zu denken geben. Und jetzt, glaube ich, sind wir uns alle einig, der Staat kann Innovation weder verordnen noch erzwingen. Es sind immer einzelne Persönlichkeiten, die etwas erfinden, die den Mut haben, einen Schritt weiterzugehen als andere, die etwas verändern. Aber ein Staat und auch die Europäische Union kann trotzdem natürlich versuchen, Rahmenbedingungen zu schaffen, die Innovation möglich machen. Und vielleicht ein paar schnelle Gedanken, wo ich glaube, dass eine Trendumkehr notwendig ist und wo wir uns als Bundesregierung uns auch bemühen, diese Trendumkehr einzuleiten. Zum ersten Budgetpolitik. Es hat bei uns in Österreich immer 2 Grundregeln gegeben in der Budgetpolitik, nämlich zum einen, dass Budgets immer fortgeschrieben werden, dass kaum gewichtet wird, wo man mehr und wo man weniger investieren möchte und zum zweiten, dass wir, egal wie es gerade gelaufen ist, immer mehr ausgegeben haben, als wir zur Verfügung hatten. Das führt zu Schulden, zu steigenden Zinsen und zu immer geringeren budgetären Spielräumen, um wirklich gezielt zu investieren. Insofern ist ein Ende der Schuldenpolitik der erste Schritt, um langfristig mehr Budgetspielräume zu bekommen. Und es ist vor allem richtig, wenn man dann auch noch den Schritt macht und gezielt investiert. Wir bemühen uns derzeit, in 2 Bereiche mehr und in anderen weniger zu investieren, nämlich in Sicherheit und in Bildung mehr und dafür in anderen Bereichen zu reduzieren. 2. Punkt neben der Budgetpolitik, Steuerlast reduzieren. Eine zu hohe Steuerlast führt gerade für Startups, für kleine Unternehmen dazu, dass sie sich Mitarbeiter nicht leisten können oder Mitarbeiter von ihren Gehältern nicht oder kaum leben können, führt dazu, dass Talente abwandern, Investitionen anderswo stattfinden und natürlich dann auch dazu, dass Innovation gedrosselt wird. Dritter Gedanke, Deregulierung. Wir haben heute schon viel darüber diskutiert. Ein funktionierender Rechtsstaat lebt von Gesetzen, von Regelungen, von einer starken Verwaltung, die das auch exekutiert. Aber in Europa sind wir nicht gerade auf dem Weg, ein Problem mit zu wenig Regeln zu haben, sondern eher ein Problem mit zu vielen Regeln. Was gleichzeitig entsteht, ist eine ganze Dienstleistungsindustrie, die dann wieder beratend tätig ist, wie man Regeln bestmöglich umgehen oder umschiffen kann. Aber es führt nicht unbedingt zu mehr Innovation. Und ich glaube, unser genereller europäischer Reflex auf Innovation im ersten Schritt einmal mit mehr an Regulierung zu reagieren, ist ein gefährlicher. Vierter Punkt, internationale Anbindung. Die Rektorin hat schon angesprochen, was für die Wirtschaftsuniversität gilt, gilt für einen Staat genauso. Der Austausch mit der Welt ist für ein kleines, exportorientiertes Land unverzichtbar. Und wenn dann nicht nur internationale Gäste kommen, um Reden zu halten, sondern vielleicht auch da und dort Menschen zu uns kommen, als Talente kommen, um zuwandern zu wollen, hier zu bleiben und hier tätig zu sein, dann ist das umso erfreulicher. Wir arbeiten gerade daher an einer Reform der Rot-Weiß-Rot-Card. Wir sind zwar relativ attraktiv im europäischen Vergleich, es ist aber gerade für Hochqualifizierte oft nicht sonderlich attraktiv, monatelang darauf zu warten, bis sie die Möglichkeit haben zu wissen, ob sie zuwandern dürfen oder nicht. Fünftens, europäische Zusammenarbeit. Ich glaube, bei großen Projekten, ganz gleich, ob das jetzt künstliche Intelligenz ist, die Vollendung des digitalen Binnenmarkts oder europäische Batterien, die in Europa auch wirklich entwickelt und produziert werden, all das kann ein kleiner Staat nicht alleine tun, da braucht es die europäische Zusammenarbeit. Und der letzte Gedanke, der wahrscheinlich der wichtigste ist, ich glaube, in der Frage, welche Staaten dieser Welt sind erfolgreich, welche Staaten dieser Welt sind Innovation Leader, geht es meistens nicht um die Größe des Staates, es geht meistens nicht mal um die Geschichte des Staates, sondern relevant ist, ob man möchte oder nicht, ob der Wille da ist. Und ich glaube, was es daher auch braucht, ist ein Stück weit eine Änderung im Mindset. In der Frage zum Beispiel, haben wir Freude an Fortschritt und Innovation oder ist es vor allem einmal Angst, die da ausgelöst wird? Gibt es genug junge Menschen, die nicht nur einen sicheren Job im öffentlichen Dienst wollen, so wie ich, sondern auch bereit sind, Unternehmer zu werden, Risiko einzugehen und ein Unternehmen zu gründen? Und natürlich auch die Frage, schaffen wir es, dass wenn es beim ersten Mal nicht gelingt und man scheitert, dass man auch die entsprechende zweite Chance bekommt, denn viele der tollen, großen, führenden Unternehmen unserer Zeit waren nicht unbedingt die erste Idee oder das erste Projekt ihrer Erfinder. In diesem Sinne, lieber Eric Schmidt, vielen Dank fürs Kommen. Wir freuen uns auf eine spannende Diskussion.
Ja, Bundeskanzler Sebastian Kurz hat gesagt, Austausch und Zuzug internationaler Innovation Leader wäre das Ziel. Ich glaube nicht, dass wir schaffen werden, Eric Schmidt dazu zu überreden, dass er nach Wien zieht und hier seinen Zweitwohnsitz oder Hauptwohnsitz aufschlägt. Aber wir haben ihn heute da, er ist heute zu Gast und ich freue mich sehr, dass ich Eric Schmidt nun auf die Bühne bitten darf. Ich werde jetzt auch an dieser Stelle ins Englische wechseln. Want to be more polite and want to say hello and welcome again from my side. I'm very honored to welcome Eric Schmidt, who will talk to us approximately 15 to 20 minutes. And then you all have, I will have a couple of questions to him, but you all are invited to ask questions to Eric. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I want to congratulate Austria for having perhaps the most consequential chancellor in Europe, who I've gotten to know over the last few years and who has made a huge impression about your country around the world, and in particular because of his dynamism and his vision for a stronger economy, stronger innovation, stronger risk-taking, represents not only a strong leader, but also a new set of ideas that could ultimately transform Europe in a really wonderful way. So thank you very much for your invitation, Mr. Chancellor, and thank you for serving as a place for new ideas and new leadership in the whole continent, not just in your own country. So thank you. I have spent a lot of time thinking about what's the most important thing about human society. And I will tell you that the most important thing is individual freedom. Freedom to think, freedom to act, freedom to learn, freedom to collect, freedom to found companies, freedom as an individual to do the things that you as an adult think are most important to make the world a better place. I am worried that we, in the complicated politics of the globe today, are forgetting how important that underlying principle is. And also that the links that we have built over the last 100 or 200 years that represent globalization are becoming devalued. That it's incredibly important that America be integrated with Europe and Asia, and that Europe be integrated among itself, and that Austria be integrated with all of her neighbors, and that the ideas that go between them, that the globalization of ideas and opportunity are fundamental to solving the next problem. I say this as a scientist, I say it as a businessman, and I say it as a citizen. I can't imagine that we want to go back to the United States in its own continent, and Europe in its own continent, and each of the countries in Europe at various conflict among each other, without the interchange that is represented by the best of the world. And what I like about Austria is that you have a history as a country, 100 years and more ago, of being that center for much of the Eastern Europe region. You understand that the power of being a small country is the fact that you have other markets. You have people you can collaborate with. You have people you can sell to. You can have people who want to come live in Vienna and in your country because it's such a great place. You understand the value of immigrants. You understand the values of relatively open borders. You understand the value of educating everyone else. You understand the value of diversity. All of that, right, modern Austria, right, is a key part of your growth. That's what I like about the country. I would like to offer a set of thoughts for you about how to go forward. When I look at Europe, I look at Europe as an American who sees Europe as proud but moving too slowly in a number of areas. And in particular, I see the opportunity of young people and education and formation of companies as a next great opportunity. So I'll give you my thesis. And my thesis is that Europe does not have enough software people, that Austria does not produce enough software people, that there is not enough investment in digitalization, that there is not enough of an understanding of the power of software to transform businesses and economies. And you sit there and you go, well, we have lots of software people, but not compared to any of the other countries, and certainly not compared to the United States. In the United States, software has taken over the universities to the point where the number one major in the universities in the United States is computer science. And in Europe, it's much harder to achieve that. It's much harder to get that amount of change in the universities for all sorts of reasons. Another thing that I would say about Europe is the universities as a group have less money. The American universities look rich to a European. The American universities have a great deal of money for extra research and postdocs and research labs and so forth. And yet we know, we know being Google, that the quality of the European students and graduates are excellent. So we don't have a human problem, we have a systems problem. We need more money in the universities, we need more investment in software, and we need more software people. So
you sit there and you go, why? What are all these software people going to do? And the answer is they're going to invent the future. And they're going to do it because software is a way of transforming every business, every government, and every set of intellectual pursuits in a way that's much more powerful, and I'll describe that. But I have two components of my solution. The first is entrepreneurship, and the second one is artificial intelligence. Entrepreneurship is pretty easy to understand. You have to be willing to take risks. Many European countries are relatively risk intolerant in the sense that the cultures don't reward risk in the way that they should, in my view. And furthermore, there is a fear of failure. One of the key characteristics of the Silicon Valley model is that people fail, and that we routinely hire people who have gone bankrupt. I figure that if we hire them because they went bankrupt, they learned a lot. In other words, it's not a moral failing, it's a learning opportunity. And the system is flexible enough within reason, right, to allow for redemption and new ideas. And the interesting thing, and I teach entrepreneurship now, is that entrepreneurs are a special breed. They're people who, when they wake up in the morning, they want to do what they want to do with your help or without you. They're sure in a way that I am not. They know that they can invent this solution in medicine, this solution in business, this solution in science, this solution in the arts. They're the creators of something new. We tend to forget that the very famous people in all of our history, go back to German history and Austrian history and so forth, they were entrepreneurs too. They were just as confused when they were 22 years old as our current entrepreneurs are. But they were successful and they became famous and then they became old and then they became historic. But they were entrepreneurs as well because they changed things. And the interesting thing about entrepreneurs is they don't just come from the top university. They don't just come from here. They come from little towns and big towns and foreign countries. And often they're hungry. And often they're not from the privileged families. Often they're from people who are scrappy and gutsy. Often there are cases where they're immigrants and they're orphans. And they have all sorts of terrible personal stories which drove them to this drive and vision to create things. So I've learned that entrepreneurship comes everywhere, and it comes in many different colors. It comes in men and women. It comes in all sorts of races and political views and sexual views and so forth and so on. Entrepreneurship is not a job of any one category. It's everyone can be an entrepreneur. Now, why do you need entrepreneurs? Because entrepreneurs start things. In Google's case, the government was involved as well. The government founded something called the Digital Libraries Project. The Digital Libraries Project occurred in the 1990s. It was a relatively modest program that money went, among other things, to Stanford. There were two young graduate students named Larry and Sergey who were inspired by that work, and today Google is the world's largest digital library. Right? So how long did that take? 25 years. More recently in Europe, in Britain, a group founded a company called DeepMind. In 2010, this is a group of neuroscientists, and they thought there's a new way to think about how brain works and how thinking works. And we acquired them some years ago, and they, for example, built algorithms which allowed humans to build computers that could build the best humans at the game of Go, which is considered to be the hardest game in the world. And it does it not by algorithmic approaches, but by learning. You need entrepreneurs to create companies, to create the great businesses of the future. And I can assure you that the entrepreneurs that we are talking about today will have a certain profile. They will be a little bit insane. They'll be a little bit crazy. They'll be a little bit driven. They'll be a little bit unusual. They'll also have a deep understanding of what they're trying to solve in biology, in science, in platforms, in communications, in art, in sport. They'll be deeply knowledgeable. I've had the privilege of working with the top entrepreneurs in the world. For example, Steve Jobs, I was on his board for a long time. And I've known everybody, and obviously I work with Larry and Sergey every day. And these are people of extraordinary gifts, right, who have a deep understanding of what they're trying to do, and they can really drive society forward. And those are the kinds of people that I know Austria has, can create, and can train. And by the way, universities need to reward this. They need to have entrepreneurship programs, they need to encourage it, they need to educate people, and they have to make it possible. Part of the reason that Silicon Valley works so well now is because we've had so much practice. We have so many examples of this. We've learned how when the entrepreneur shows up, we know what to do with them. He or she is put through the mill and trained quickly, given a lot of money, and then there's all sorts of attention and very little time to succeed. Enormous pressure. Is that true here? Not enough. That's what's important. The government can help, but if you go back to what I said earlier about freedom, there's also freedom to own your own outcomes. And ultimately, the responsibility is not on the government, but on the entrepreneur. It's ultimately the entrepreneur that does the work. The government's job is to create the environment with, for example, forgiveness of initial taxes and regulatory relief and various forms of initial research funding and additional promotional help, things that make sense that are consistent with capitalism. The second part of entrepreneurialism and this narrative is what's going on in my field, which is artificial intelligence and computer science. When I was a computer scientist and when I was a programmer, we wrote everything algorithmically. Turn left, turn right, do this, do that, so forth and so on. It's very didactic, right? Do this, do that. But there's a new possibility now, which is where the system is trained to do things. You use artificial intelligence every day when you use Google Translate or Google Photos. I'll give you an example. If you type in zebra into Google Photos, it will show you pictures of zebras. Now, we did not sit there and say, we can imagine what a zebra looks like, and a zebra has this shape and that shape and so forth. What we did is we took all the pictures that said zebra, and we taught a computer how to recognize a zebra using something called deep neural networks. These deep neural networks allow you to recognize things and learn from training. Another example is that there's a disease called diabetic retinopathy, which is difficult to diagnose in the back of your retina. If you have diabetes, you can develop a disease where you lose your sight, and it's common in the developing world. This is easily seen if you take a picture of the retina. So it turns out that with diabetic retinopathy, and again, this has all been published, we are more accurate than the best ophthalmologists. Now, how could that be? We're not doctors. Well, it's easy. We saw more eyes. We saw millions of eyes to train to learn what diabetic retinopathy worked like. That principle, the principle of training for labeled data and then learning the outcome, is at the key of much of the artificial intelligence revolution. It's pretty easy now to do what I just described. Indeed, Google has released a library called TensorFlow, which includes the libraries to do this, so you don't even have to learn how do the technical aspects of the algorithm work, which is difficult to understand. You can just take your pictures and do the recognition. Now, where would you use this? Well, how about self-driving cars? If vision is better in a computer, wouldn't you rather have the computer driving the car rather than the human? I mean, this is Austria. Austrians like to drive, right? Or, you know, we love the auto industry and so forth. But it will be safer to have the computer driving the car, especially if you're drinking, right? Or something else. You see my point, right? It makes sense that eventually, most people will get to where they're going by computers that are self-driving, by cars that are self-driving and where the person is watching the computer. What about doctors? Well, I go to the doctor and I say on my skin, you know, look at that, and the doctor says, and I'm always worried, I say, oh, it must be cancer, and he goes, it's not cancer, you're always worried about this. I'd rather have the computer do that diagnostic because the computer will be more accurate statistically than even the best doctors, and then have the computer give the diagnosis to the doctor, and the doctor can say to Eric, calm down, you're not dying, okay? Typical, so the doctor becomes more accurate. Now, why does the two examples that I gave you, why does that matter to you? What's one of the characteristics of Europe and in particular of Austria that's worrisome? It's the demographics. You have an increasing number of older people and a decreasing percentage of young people who are going to be doing the work. In other words, you. And your job is to pay the pensions of all the old people, right? And in order to, and there's more of them, so how are they going to have their nice lifestyle? You're going to have to work harder. Well, you're already working hard. A better way is to give you tools to make you more productive. So one way to think about it is we want to make you, as young people, more, literally more efficient, more productive using these tools so that you can provide economic growth and the country's revenue can grow and, of course, well-being for everyone old and new. If you follow that reasoning, then these are known opportunities from artificial intelligence and entrepreneurship. And when you create your company here in Vienna or elsewhere, you're highly likely to be founding a company that uses these tools. Where would you use them? You would use it in medicine. You would use it in transportation and logistics. But let me make some other examples. Why is it that the human brain uses 20 watts and the biggest computers use, I don't know, 10 megawatts, and they still can't do anything like the brain? There's so much we don't know about human intelligence and intelligence in general. Why don't we work on that problem? I'll give you another example. Thank goodness this is a country that actually believes climate change is real. Right? What a shock. Right? These techniques allow you to build distribution systems that are much more accurate. And you go, well, they can't be that much more accurate. Google has a data center, and our data centers are, according to us, managed and designed by the best engineers in the whole world, according to us. And so our software team came in and they figured out using these algorithms to make a 15%, 15% in energy use. 15%. Now think about the goals of the European Union, CO2 distribution, efficiency. What would 15% do for the energy picture for Europe? It's a very big number. Do I think that's possible? I suspect it's more. Right? I suspect there's an even greater gain possible from this. Now, why is that a good thing? Well, it's clearly good for the planet because climate change is real and we want to reduce our carbon emission. But it's also good because it causes prices to go down. It means less waste, better utilization. So these are cases where efficiency, utilization, and scale are all in alignment. It's a win for everybody. But this distribution principle applies to many other businesses, right? That's another example. I would like to see us take a position from entrepreneurship and AI that's even more aggressive. And I'll finish by giving you some examples of things that I'm doing personally. And obviously, we'll have your questions in a minute. I think it's possible to use these techniques to solve many problems that have bedeviled humanity for a very long time. I will use as an example medicine. It's obvious that if you take the techniques that I'm describing and you pair them with medical scientists who are looking for new drugs to solve terrible diseases, they generate an enormous amount of data. And what we know now is these computers can see patterns that humans can't see. Right. A simple example from the United States is that computers can do better organic chemistry than humans can. By the way, organic chemistry is essentially mixing and matching complicated molecules together to make new compounds. It turns out computers can do that faster. That's an example. But let's set some other goals. Let's set a goal, for example, of understanding climate change modeling better than we know now. Today, the level of resolution that the supercomputers can do, as the Chancellor mentioned, right, we have limits in terms of Moore's Law. Why don't we figure out if we can take the resolution from 10 kilometers, which is roughly the resolution of the models that they can use today in Navier-Stokes equation, to much better. We can do that by using artificial intelligence and then using approximations to those solutions to, in a hybrid way, use traditional math and then these new techniques to help us make better climate models. I'm funding that with a US group based out of Caltech. Another example, I would like to find a group, I haven't found it yet, that solves the following problem. If you look at math, It looks to me like 12 or 13 year olds and math is where people get on or off. In the United States, this is called the eighth grade math problem. I don't know what the grade is called here. But around 12 or 13, the math gets really hard, and some people love it, that was me, and a whole bunch of people hate it, and that was a whole bunch of other people. And people who are like me ended up in the technology fields and have done far better economically because they're analytically trained. It looks to me like if we could build AI agents, that is, systems that would help coach people through eighth grade math, that would have a big impact. That's my opinion. It's a supposition. We know that with special coaching, you can take specific individuals, but that's too expensive. But if we're going to solve that problem, why don't we also solve another problem that is well understood? The children of rich people have much better verbal skills and developmental skills than the children of the very poor. And it has to do with the number of books and the educational level of the families and whether they have access to kindergarten and so forth. Why don't we solve that problem by building systems for very young children that allow them to engage in language and culture that is repetitive and training in a way that makes sense to them, that learns from them, right? That's another huge opportunity. So I've already mentioned medicine, I've mentioned transportation, I've mentioned this question about education. What about figuring out ways of creating more food quality and density, better biomass in the ocean for foodstuffs, less use of fertilizers on the land? I can go on and on. Each of these are projects that are underway by people in the scientific community who will ultimately create very large companies for one reason or another. So let me finish by saying, I started by saying that I think that you have an opportunity because of your history and your position in the world to change what you're doing, to take more risk, to aim higher. But in order to do that, you have to make some changes in your educational system to encourage more entrepreneurs, to have them stay in Austria, and also to build links with the neighboring countries. There's enormous technical talent in Hungary and in the Balkans and so forth. I suspect that they would prefer to live and work in Vienna and go back and forth with their families because the quality of life might be a little bit more sophisticated here. And yet, right, they're there and you're here. How do you figure out a way to build companies that attract them to build the companies of tomorrow headquartered in Austria? I think you can take a position that the opportunities that I've described, of which there are, I can come up with many more, are all ones that you could take, right? You have a historic role as a small country working with all the countries around you. You're not that dissimilar from, I don't know, the Netherlands. But look at some success stories. Singapore on the Chinese side, Chinese and Malay side, and look at Israel on the in that part of the world. These are small countries that are punching way above their weight because they got the formula right. And I think that opportunity is before you today. So thank you very much.
Do you want to? Do you have a preference of chair? Whether you want to. Thank you very much for this inspiring talk. First of all, I would like to say thank you that you are so positive and polite when it comes to analyzing Austria and our history. But still, I have the feeling when I look at the title of our of this talk and of this afternoon, and after listening to you, I have the feeling there's one clear thing that says we have to change to get better, to get quicker and to leave the past that we are in. So first of all, I wanted to ask you, you said now a couple of concrete things, but I want to get even more concrete. What would you say, how can change and innovation management, and it's basically that, work for a whole continent as Europe is? I mean, you talked a lot about Austria, that's true, and we have a lot of things that are benefiting our situation. We're in the middle of Europe and we have an important history, but how can this change of of a whole continent work? And one small question, what do you think, how long would that take to make changes?
So let's ask we're in a university, let's consider the hypothetical, you don't do any change at all. Nothing changes, right? So the country ages gracefully. Right? It's good. It's a beautiful place, right? Right? We age gracefully, we have fewer and fewer people, right? We don't do any new software. The existing businesses continue as they are. Eventually, other countries and other businesses will get the software right, and your businesses will radically and then dramatically drop off. So I would argue that the change is not an option, it's a requirement. And there is a perception in Europe that I've heard over the years that you don't have to change. But at least in the business world, change is a requirement because of competition. And I'll give you an example. Let's say you decide that it's hunky-dory here and we love it here and we don't need to change at all. Look at the dynamic vibrancy of China and India and the growth rate and the impact of Asia on all of Europe. Right, so that's sort of the first question is, do you have to do something? And with respect, Mr. Chancellor, you have to do something, and I know you want to, but I the option of saying, oh, okay, I had a good time, right? It's a really great, comfy place, not a good chance. The second thing that happens in Europe is Europeans, in my experience, spend an awful lot of time complaining about the rest of Europe, which often includes Brussels. And we are in the country of Austria with the federal chancellor. So my first question is, what are the things that are under your control? What are the things that you can do to make this possibility? Now, there are plenty of things that are not under your control. For example, not unlike America, you can't just decide to run deficits forever, right? Different country, different systems. But you can influence. But so you want to distinguish between the things that you control and the things that you can influence. Now, at the things that you control, I would like to see a strong commitment, again, with respect, Mr. Chancellor, with respect to your government, a strong commitment to entrepreneurship, a strong commitment to this kind of change, and a strong commitment to asking higher level questions, right? In other words, let's go higher. Let's go for the whole business, not a part of the business. And even if you don't get there, you'll get a better quality person because people want to work on the hard problem. And it's fun. It's fun to talk about changing the world from Austria, right? From Vienna, right? A centerpiece of great culture and art for a thousand years, what have you. And then with respect to Europe, I think most Americans, and it's my view, is too much regulation, too much sort of statism, not dynamic enough. And I'm not suggesting in any way that America is perfect. There's a long list starting with, well, I won't go into that. I think it's pretty obvious what my views are. But if you look at economic dynamism, which is creation of new companies, mobility, the United States economic dynamism is slowing. It's slowing in Europe more, which is going exactly in the wrong direction. We want more new ideas, more investment, so forth, in Europe as well as in the United States.
I would say one of the most important steps to this change is the educational system. Yeah. And I would like to know from you, what would you say, how can we, apart from the fact that maybe also the educational system as a whole should get over a change, but what would you say, how can we encourage and empower young people, we have so many young people here in the audience, to this entrepreneurial thinking? I mean, it's on the one hand, it's a university that offers an environment, but then it's also how can we really, as you said at the beginning, tell the people that it is important to be such an entrepreneurial thinker, and what does it take for that?
So, again, as a broad statement about Europe, the European universities are very change resistant. It's very difficult, I don't know if the students feel this way or not, it's very difficult to get the percentage of faculty in one area changed. It's very difficult to get new things started in universities here. It's much easier in America, partly because there's a great deal more money, which is, I think Europe needs more money for its universities, and I'm consistent on that. But second, because the corporations are closely aligned with the universities. There's better and tighter relationships between universities and corporations in America than there is here, and the corporations tend to drive that. In Google's case, we work very closely with individual faculty members. We give them grants, right? We Google, and then of course many of their top graduates come work for us. So it works for both very, very well. I'd like to see more of that kind of technical collaboration, so forth. It's interesting that in Europe, the drug industry and the pharmaceutical industry is very good and very, very strong, and it works very closely with universities. Why not everyone else? Right? Why restrict it just to pharmaceuticals?
Mm-hmm. With the look of the time, I would really like to invite all of you who are here, because I think that's also what Eric Schmidt is very interesting in, to hear questions from you. So please, there are two people going through with microphones. I see the first hand here in the last row, and I would like to take three questions. Let's just do one question after another. Please.
Hi, I'm Marcus. I'm running a think tank on entrepreneurship in Austria.
Perfect.
Yeah, it's perfect. And you talked about universities, and it's a big problem. But I also want to talk about early education, because there's quite some statistics that show that the situation here is pretty dramatic.
The global good or bad?
Bad.
Bad, okay.
The Global Entrepreneurship Monitor says that Austria has the worst entrepreneurial education in the whole EU. I think Eurobarometer, I heard, also lately found that 80% of 14-year-olds in Austria don't believe they can realize their own ideas. So I would ask you for some actionable advice for our government, how they can change that. Because changing education, as you said, is very difficult and it takes time. But we need to be more radical here. So what would be your advice?
My general advice is that the change won't happen until there's a series of meetings where people say there's a crisis. In other words, things are pretty good here, right? It's a beautiful place, everyone's healthy, right? Congratulations, graduate, go off to your job, right? You have to create at least something of a crisis. It can be an external crisis, it can be an external, or it can also come from leadership from the chancellor and his office. But you've got to have somebody drive it. There has to be a reason to change. Mr. Chancellor, do you want to add anything?
I saw two hands in the middle of, here's one, this guy, young man here in the, with the black shirt, sweater. Here, no, in the fourth row, here.
Thank you. My name is Alexander Hoffer. I'm with the Strategy and Innovation Master Program at WU. And my question is for Mr. Schmidt. First of all, thank you for being here. You talked a lot of things. You talked a lot about the positive aspects about AI, but you haven't touched the risks that are also involved. And for example, Elon Musk said a lot about that topic. Can you maybe elaborate on the risks of AI?
So Elon, of course, also invested in OpenAI, which is one of the great new groups of people working in this area. There is a tendency to want to translate what you see in the movies and apply it to the AI that I'm describing. So I want to be clear that killer robots are not part of the plan, right? And furthermore, if a startup in Austria created killer robots, right, it would get regulated, right? So I don't worry about that side of it. there are issues with AI. The most obvious one is bias. So because AI systems are trained from existing data, you could imagine bias creeping into those systems. A classic example would be racial bias or sexist bias, which would not be acceptable. There are people working on technical solutions to that, but that's the kind of thing I worry about with AI. I don't worry about the movie scenarios, at least not for a while, like decades.
Yes, behind you, yep.
You were talking about the maximization of freedom and that this is one of the core principles. And you were also talking about artificial intelligence. So in that respect, I would be interested in if you think there is a limitation to freedom when it comes to artificial intelligence. So should it be able, should everybody be able to use it for any purpose? So for example, if we talk about killer robots, Google, I think, had a contract with the US military to work on drone footage. And there has been some resistance from within the company. And now I'm interested in where you would personally draw the line and why.
So it's interesting that the company actually went through this debate and published a set of AI principles which define where that boundary is. And I would encourage you to read them because I support the principles. I think they make sense. For every new technology, there's the ability to misuse it. With electricity came the possibility of the electric chair. Right, but that doesn't mean that electricity is not useful. It just means you have to decide not to build electric chairs. So it makes sense, right, that these things are powerful. And I don't want to understate the power of AI. It is transformative. It transforms businesses, societies. It can be misused. And that's why the principles are so important. And by the way, just to review, but again, I'd refer to just use your favorite search engine. You'll find them. And they include things like, the system needs to do what it claims to do. The system needs to not be misused by the military. The system needs to not have bias in it. There's a list of them, and you read it.
Here, this woman next to you, just, yeah.
Hi, I have a question about opportunities for students, okay? I know of two students from the VU who had, one of them won the innovation idea in 2010. He had tried to launch his business in Austria, in Eastern Europe, and could not find funding. I'd like to ask you, he flew over to Asia, kicked off his company within 6 months, sold the business for over 30 million euros, and is convinced that the situation in Austria is not the lack of ideas of the young students, but the system or the institutions do not trust the young. I'd like your comments on that, because two of these students are VU, they're bicultural students, and they have actually made millions in Asia. Well, is there more freedom of funding over there, or I'm really curious.
So the chancellor mentioned that he's met the gentleman you're referring to.
Yeah.
In Hong Kong. He's a good example of why we need to address these issues here in your country. You need more than the entrepreneurs, you need the funding sources. My friends in Europe say that they still, at some level, need to go to the U.S. for financial resources. Many of the most interesting companies have ended up needing to get U.S. funding, even out of Britain and so forth. Google has announced and has operating a fund of at least $100 million to do investments in Europe and so forth, but we need an ecosystem. So again, this is another problem to work on, but it's a solvable problem. It doesn't require new physics, right? You could just copy the financial structures, the economic structures that were pioneered in the United States in Europe as a whole, and the banking system should be able to make money at this. The other comment I would make about entrepreneurs is remember most of them fail, right? That the vast majority of ideas don't become Apple and Google and so forth and so on, but that's okay, because through that failure, the dynamism of the economy is increased. Things are advanced, companies are often acquired by others, and so forth.
This young man here with the glasses. What's the first one?
This question is also for you, Mr. Schmidt. Thank you very much for being here. You talked about the issues and problems within demographics worldwide, not only Europe, but still speak highly of AI and increased productivities of companies while hiring as little people as possible. Now, I want to ask you how this does sort of like go together in the long run.
Well, actually, the way you said it, it sounds like there's a disconnect, but there's not. What is characteristic of Austria that's also characteristic of the EU, which is also characteristic of Britain, which is also characteristic of America, which is also characteristic of China, which is also characteristic of South Korea and Japan, declining demographic performance, literally below the replacement rate. And every country is facing this problem that I described as humorously as I could, of increasing numbers of old people and young people supporting them. How are we going to continue economic growth in these countries? And the answer is that we will help them become more productive. What that specifically meant 100 years ago was automating the farm with agribusinesses and threshers and those kinds of things. And then later in the automation of factories, which again, you're very advanced in, it's the use of manufacturing robots to replace the most repetitive of jobs. So the path for AI for the next decade is to replace the most boring and predictable of human activities, not the creative ones, not the ones that involve our interaction. A simple example is when you ask audiences, what would they like AI to do for them? Inevitably they say, we'd like a robot to put away the dishes. Okay. Well, that turns out to be one of the hardest problems in AI, because recognizing what the dish is, what's on it, how to clean it, and how to put it away and where it goes turns out to be a pretty hard problem. And I'm pleased to say that people are working on this problem very hard.
Now, in the second row, there's a lady here with the...
Claudia Nuss, entrepreneur. I'm really grateful for your inspiring speech. Our chancellor mentioned before that the Austrian mindset is somewhat self-limiting and that we're rather scared of innovation. Do you have any suggestions how to improve our mindset?
Well, one answer, which worked pretty well, was to create a few wealthy people and get envy going, right? So, in other words, I mean, you sound like I'm joking, but I think if we could create some, if you could become, an incredibly important, iconic leader of your business, CEO, and so forth in the country, I think that would help inspire another generation. A lot of people need permission to do things. So in my case, I'm not an entrepreneur, I'm a follower. But I had permission from the founders in the companies that I went to behave the way I did. In other words, I would have not become such a good business person on the technical side had I not been given the permission to behave that way by the iconic leaders. So you should be my inspiration, right? And with your success, the other people in the room, the majority of the people are not entrepreneurs, they'll follow you. One of the things that's true about entrepreneurs is that they're like rock stars in that we should celebrate them. We all want to be one, but very few of us are capable of those skills. But we're all influenced by their success. They all become important to us. They make the society more interesting. And by the way, entrepreneurs are not perfect. They have all sorts of drama and problems and so forth, and so that becomes very interesting in and of itself. Part of the human narrative.
And with respect to freedom and competition, do you think the access to data should also be rather free for smaller entrepreneurs? Because bigger tech companies now have some market power with that respect, not only to capital, but also to knowledge, because they can act faster and they might set up some burdens to market entry. So do you think there's too much market power or concentration with that respect?
I answer the question with a different way of expressing the problem, which is that in order to do the companies that I'm describing, you need good access to training data. And the best training data is the data that's publicly available to everyone. And the history in AI was that there was a group that founded something called ImageNet. And ImageNet was just a group of pictures that anyone could analyze. And there was a huge competition among all the players to try to get recognition better. So I think the more that we have public access to data like that and data repositories, we'll be fine. I think you need some kind of training data that's available inexpensively, ideally free. I don't think it necessarily follows I think the way you framed it is it's the old model, which is there's captive data that one company has that's not available to anyone else. That's not in fact how it works. As long as you have enough training data, you'll be fine.
Okay, so many hands, it's impossible to get all the questions. This young man here, in the closest to you now, yeah.
So I'm a computer science student at the TU. I found your keynote very inspiring. Now I noticed how you were mentioning that European universities need more money. I don't know if you know about that, but we EU citizens are paying €19.70 per semester for university. But even citizens outside...
It's a bargain.
Yeah.
You should be very happy. Thank you to the world for making that possible.
Yeah, and I hope that Mr. Kurz will keep that way.
No, he's proposing to raise it.
Now, as I understood it, you were implying that American universities have more money.
No, it is a fact that they do. They have three times more.
Yeah, but I mean, in the USA, you have to pay more, so you have student debt. So my question would be, what's better, if it's easier to get into a university, or if the university has more money?
So the good news is, I'd like to have more money in the system, and I think more choices. So more private universities, more government funding, more partnerships with corporations, more private philanthropy, just more of everything is a better answer. In the United States, there are plenty of universities you can go to where it's almost as inexpensive as you described. In California, when California post-war, the tuition was free for California universities, which helped make the California boom, which is, you know, California is 10% of the American population and more of the California of the U.S. economy. However, the state also then began to run out of money and started to raise the non-tuition fees to numbers which are astronomical for you. So it's not a perfect system, but America has a history of free universities. There were things called land-grant universities, which were largely agricultural. My father taught at one for a long time. So we have a history of that as well. At the end of the day, I don't care how the money gets in, I just care that there's more, and then more opportunity for students.
One last question, the young man here in the last row of this part of the hall.
Thank you. My name is Nikolai Thalmayer, I'm a student of business administration here at WU, and you mentioned a lot about the fact that innovation comes from software, new software. But we are business administration students, at least a lot of us, and we don't know much about software. Do you think we should all quit our studies and change to IT studies?
Well, let me tell you what I would do if I were a business student. I would begin to study data science. Because all business is going to be the study of data and data opportunities. And there's a whole new movement to teach data science across the world using new tools. And data science is not statistics. It's the study of data and its implications, and that's what I would do.
Thank you.
So, and because it was such a short question, a short answer, we take the last question of the young man here in the same row.
Hello, my name is Andreas Denner. And my question is, at the beginning it was said we try to build a new Google. And the question is, won't we always be second? If we try to copy now the United States?
So it's always a mistake to try to directly copy an incumbent in my industry, because the incumbent can move forward. You have to come up with something which is orthogonal, that is some new approach. Right?
B?
Well, that's what your job as an entrepreneur is to find that. What we need is what happens with incumbents is they become wedded to their own religion. They become wedded to their approach. And then a new company comes along with a more targeted approach that's different, and then they grow. By the way, that's what Google did. That's what Apple did. That's what Amazon did. That's what Facebook did. Even Microsoft did that, right? Five most valuable companies in the world.
And what could we do differently as a continent?
I think the continent needs to be more tolerant of entrepreneurship, more tolerant of risk, and more favorable for the investments in it. One of the key things is, I just mentioned the five successful, most successful companies in the United States, and in fact globally. But for them, remember, there are 50,000 companies that tried to do pieces that didn't quite get there. So it's important to recognize that you need 1,000, sorry to be American, at-bats for one of these levels of success, or maybe 10,000 for one. And one of the principles of luck is you want to have more chances, more at-bats. You're lucky when you keep trying, right? And if it doesn't work the first time, you try again and so forth. Many of my friends have done 3 or 4 companies, and then the fourth one is huge success. But they had to do the, and you sit there and you go, well, why did you have to do the first three? After all, they were huge failures. Well, that's where they learned. So in my case, I was recruited by Larry and Sergey, but I'd already been in the industry and I'd already seen many successes and failures. And so I was able, when I joined the team, to add some value by saying that will work, that won't work, and that will work. Mm-hmm. It was from experience. You can't teach that. You have to live it.
So we take out of that again that failure is also an option, and it's not bad to fail. I would like to ask you one last question, maybe a bit on a personal note. Maybe you can tell us, what would you say is the one thing, the one important thing that was that you learned at school or university, and also in the, I would say, in the early years of your career, that that was important for you for the whole career you did finally?
Well, I have to be honest that I think for me it was that I was lucky. Mm-hmm. That I was early in technology and that I liked what I did and I worked very hard on it. And I was, you know, curious and creative at the time, and the faculty took an interest in me. And what I love about my own story is that people took a bet on me, right? I was hired young. They gave me opportunities. And had that not occurred, I wouldn't have had all of the experience that then enabled me to eventually end up at Google. They wouldn't have hired me. So your career is really a lot about who mentors you, how they allow you to grow, how they allow you to fail. And one of the great things about universities is they do this well.
Thank you very much for this insight.
Thank you
for coming.
Much.
Thank you all for coming this afternoon. And I wish all of you a wonderful Friday afternoon and a wonderful weekend. Thank you very much.
Thank you.